the security seminar series, and it's a great pleasure to welcome back again Steve Walt to the Watts Institute. He has been here several times since I've been at Brown, but he's also, most importantly, just finished serving two terms on the Watts Institute Board of Overseers, so we're very thrilled.
It was my fault. Whatever you don't like, guy.
And he kept particularly close tabs on the security program here at the Institute, so in my case, I'm actually particularly sad that he's no longer on the board. Steve will talk to us today on what grand strategy for America? Why offshore balancing is best. It's particularly well timed with transition to a new administration, which we perhaps already know who that will be. Steve, as most of you know, it doesn't need a long introduction here, so I will not do that. In fact, I noticed on the website that says he's the Robert and Renee Belford Professor of International Affairs, period. It doesn't say anything about where, but it's at the Kane School at Harvard. He's written numerous books. I will not go over them to save us the time for your talk, and then there'll be plenty of time for Q&A. So we'll go till about 5:30, so we'll have that time for discussion.
Great. I'll talk for an hour and 29 minutes and wrap up. No, it's a real pleasure to be back here, and I want to thank Peter for inviting me. Thank all of you for coming. I'm going to present this case for a grand strategy of sort of offshore balancing, and I'll try to explain why that's superior to the strategy we've been following for the past 25 years or so, which I and others have called liberal hegemony. Some of you will probably know this is based mostly on an article that John Mearsheimer and I published in the July-August issue of Foreign Affairs. I just want to emphasize at the outset, all the good ideas in that article are mine. Anything you disagree with, that was something John insisted on, and you can take it up with him. So first point I'd make, and Peter alluded to, is that a serious discussion of American grand strategy is long overdue, and I think the 2016 election, in various ways, despite its bizarre qualities, tells us that the American people are actually interested in having that conversation. Now, on the one hand, you've got Hillary Clinton. She has at least 200 card-carrying foreign policy professionals signed up in one capacity or another as advisors. These are VIPs like, you know, Madeleine Albright, Jim Steinberg, Jake Sullivan, my colleague Nicholas Burns, dozens more. And they are the embodiment of the conventional wisdom on foreign policy, right? They just like, it's the distilled essence of our foreign policy establishment. What's even more interesting, of course, is that a whole lot of Republican foreign policy professionals have openly condemned Trump. And some of them have come out and said they're actually going to support her, even though they're not wild about her. Hardly anybody from the foreign policy establishment, however you want to define that, has endorsed Trump. Got a handful of names. They are not particularly bold-faced names in that world as well. And yet, he got the Republican nomination. His views on foreign policy, whatever you may think of them, are clearly resonating with a substantial fraction of Americans who are worried about immigration, somewhat skeptical about free trade, opposed to dumb wars, which is not exactly a bad thing to be opposed to, and convinced that a lot of American allies are free riding, something, by the way, that Democrats and Republicans have been complaining about since the 1950s or so. My own view, just for what it's worth, is that Trump has said a lot of really outrageous and stupid things about foreign policy, but not everything he says is completely wrong. And the point is that a lot of people seem to like him. For example, some of you probably know this, a Pew Research Center survey back in April of this year reported that 57% of Americans agreed with the following statement: the United States should deal with its own problems and let other states deal with theirs the best they can. 57% of Americans agree with that. 47% felt that the United States was doing too much in the world. I think only about 25% thought we were doing too little. Both Trump and also, very importantly on the left, Bernie Sanders, found very receptive audiences when they talked about fundamentally altering what the United States was doing in the world. Clinton's really the only candidate defending the status quo. Finally, Ben Page and Marshall Bouton wrote a book a few years ago based on very extensive public opinion surveys, and they argued, quote, there is a persistent disconnect between leaders and the public on foreign policy. Official U.S. foreign policy differs from the policies most Americans want. So we have something of a gap here, suggesting that the public might actually be interested in at least having a conversation about what we're doing in the world. And now, I don't think that's actually surprising, because the grand strategy we've been following has been a costly failure. In Asia, China's power steadily rising, challenging the status quo increasingly. India, Pakistan, and North Korea have all expanded their nuclear arsenals despite strong US opposition. In Europe, Russia has annexed Crimea. Relations with Moscow are worse than at any time since the Cold War. We are still fighting in Iraq and Afghanistan with no end visibly in sight. The Middle East is in turmoil, in good part due to our efforts to promote regime change in places like Iraq and Libya and Syria. Efforts to promote democracy are also going badly. According to Larry Diamond of Stanford University, in the past 15 years, democracy broke down in 27 countries, and existing dictatorships have become even less open, transparent, and responsive to their citizens. So if our goal is promoting democracy around the world, we're not doing particularly well. Repeated, highly publicized, and time-consuming efforts to broker an Israeli-Palestinian peace, something the last three presidents all tried to do, all failed rather ignominiously. Oh, and along the way, our use of torture, targeted killings, and other morally dubious practices have eroded our image as a defender of human rights and international law. Now, you could argue that American foreign policy is not solely responsible for all of that, but our fingerprints are over a lot of those events. And I would argue that these are the direct result of this strategy of liberal hegemony we have followed since the end of the Cold War. This is this idea that the United States is the indispensable nation that must use its power not just to make Americans safe and more prosperous, but to promote a liberal world order based on international institutions, democratic governments, open markets, and respect for human rights. Liberal hegemony, given that the whole world isn't organized that way already, is a highly revisionist grand strategy. Instead of the United States defending its own territory, upholding the balance of power in a few key areas, it commits us to spreading democracy around the world peacefully if we can, but if necessary, by force. It assumes we have the right, the responsibility, and the wisdom to manage local politics in lots of different corners of the world. This is very flattering to our image as, you know, the world's most wonderful place. But I think it's a fundamentally flawed way of dealing with the world. In particular, it first expands the number of places that the United States is committed to defend without increasing the resources available to do it. And if you need a good illustration of that, just think of the Baltic states, which are very hard to defend, add essentially no capability to NATO, and now we are obligated by treaty to protect them. Second, threatening or actually conducting regime change, of course, threatens other regimes who do whatever they can think of to try and make that hard for us to do and thwart our aims in other ways, including pursuing weapons of mass destruction in some cases. And finally, when we do succeed at regime change, we end up with a costly military occupation, not a stable democracy, triggering local resistance and sometimes leading to more international terrorism. So it's not surprising that Americans are at least asking whether or not this is the right way to proceed, because it hasn't gone particularly well, and there are some obvious reasons why it keeps failing. So is there an alternative? And needless to say, I think there is, which I'll call offshore balancing. As most of you can probably tell, this is a realist grand strategy. So it eschews ambitious efforts to remake other societies. It concentrates on what's really critical to American security and prosperity, which is mostly about maintaining the American position in the Western Hemisphere and countering possible hegemons in Europe, Northeast Asia, or possibly the Persian Gulf. Instead of encouraging the United States to take on burdens all over the world, it encourages other states to take the lead in checking rising powers out of their own self-interest, and calls for the United States to intervene only when it's necessary to uphold the balance of power. But it's not isolationism. The United States would remain diplomatically engaged everywhere. It would be open to foreign trade and investment. We would be doing it. We'd let others invest here. And we would endorse, it endorses the use of American military power in some well-defined circumstances. So it's not isolationism, it's not pacifism. Begins by recognizing the United States is the luckiest great power in the history of the world. All the other major powers throughout history have had to worry about other powerful states in their own regions. We don't. We're separated from all the other major powers by these two enormous oceans. Makes it hard for anybody really to threaten us directly, certainly not existentially. We also, by the way, have thousands of nuclear weapons, which makes it even less likely that anyone is going to trouble us here in the Western Hemisphere. Now, what's interesting is that those enormous advantages, the fact that the United States has this enormous margin of security, is what allows us to run around the world interfering in lots of other places without ever worrying about the consequences for us, right? If and when the United States finally leaves Afghanistan, as I think we eventually will someday, probably in my lifetime, although I'm not sure, it may be a mess for Afghanistan, but it won't be a big issue here in Rhode Island or in Kansas or Missouri or Oregon or elsewhere as well. So we can keep doing all these things even if they keep failing because we're so secure. In terms of goals, offshore balancing has two basic strategic goals. One is to preserve the American position in the Western Hemisphere, the only great power here, going back to the Monroe Doctrine. And second, unlike real isolationists who think the rest of the world sort of doesn't matter at all, offshore balancers think three regions might be worth fighting to defend: Europe, Northeast Asia, and the Persian Gulf, for these sort of good old-fashioned Kennan-esque reasons. These are areas that contain either concentrations of industrial power or, in the case of the Persian Gulf, energy resources that are essential to modern economies. The main concern in Europe and Asia is the emergence of a regional hegemon that dominates those areas the same way we dominate the Western Hemisphere. A state like that would have an economy as big as the United States, maybe bigger. It would have, if it wanted, the ability to project power around the world the way the United States currently does. It could even get involved in the Western Hemisphere and interfere in ways we might find troublesome. So for at least the last century or so, the United States has been willing to fight large wars to prevent anyone from dominating either Europe or Asia. As for the Gulf, we basically want to make sure that no one's in a position to control all the oil there because they might interfere with that, and if they did, that would affect our prosperity, if not more. So again, it's not isolationism, but notice that the aims here are quite limited. Promoting peace, while desirable, is not a central goal here. The United States does not take upon itself the mission of ensuring or guaranteeing peace in every corner of the world. And it's also not about preventing genocides. Right? Although it doesn't preclude doing that in circumstances where the danger of it is clear, there's an easy or feasible response, and American leaders are confident that acting would not make things worse. So it wouldn't preclude doing that, but that's not the purpose of the strategy. Under this strategy, we would calibrate our military commitments depending on the distribution of power in critical areas. If there's no potential hegemon in sight in Europe, Asia, or the Gulf, there's no reason for the United States to deploy ground and air forces there, and not much need for a big, enormous military establishment here in the United States. If a potential hegemon does begin to emerge in one of those areas, the first line of defense would be local actors, other regional powers there. And the United States could give them assistance, could give them advice, and could even pledge to support them in an alliance, but you'd still refrain from deploying large amounts of U.S. troops overseas. In a sense, we would be passing the buck to other states because they have the greatest interest in preventing any country from dominating them. If, however, we believe that the local powers might be unable to do the job themselves, then the United States has to do more, deploying enough military capability to shift the balance back in our favor. That could mean deploying forces in a region before a war occurred, before a struggle for power really existed, as the United States did in the Cold War in both Europe and Asia. In other cases, we might intervene after a war started if one side looked like it was likely to win and dominate, which is what we did in World Wars I and World War II. Now, I think this has several obvious advantages. It limits the number of places we're committed to defending, and it forces allies to pull their own weight, so it reduces our defense burdens. Second, by staying out of the regime change business, and in general not interfering a lot in other countries, it removes a lot of the motivation for contemporary anti-American terrorism. Not all of it, of course, but a lot of it. And just as an observation, liberal hegemony, the policy we've been following for 25 years or so, does the exact opposite. It provokes nationalist resistance, and it dismantles local institutions as we're busy trying to spread democracy, thereby creating ungoverned spaces where radical organizations can thrive and build. Offshore balancing, again, alleviates this problem by minimizing our military footprints. We don't have a lot of Americans wandering around with force in other places. And in particular, by getting us out of trying to engineer societies that we don't understand very well. And lastly, when the United States does intervene to stop a potential hegemon, and you could argue that's what we did when we invaded, or rather intervened to throw Iraq out of Kuwait in the first Gulf War in 1991, the United States and its allies are seen as a protector rather than as an occupier. And under this strategy, once you've dealt with a problem like that, you go back offshore, back over the horizon, you don't stay on the ground, you don't wear out your welcome. Now, this probably sounds like a radical strategy, and if I were in Washington, D.C., it would certainly sound like a completely crazy way of doing business. But as some of you undoubtedly know, this was, in fact, basically the guiding logic for American strategy for much of the 20th century. During the 19th century, we concentrated not on trying to run the world, we concentrated on expanding across North America, building up the American economy, and eventually establishing a dominant position in the Western Hemisphere. Again, that's what Manifest Destiny and the Monroe Doctrine were all about. At that point, the United States joins the ranks of the great powers, and it starts paying attention to the balance of power in other parts of the world. But it lets other powers take the lead, and it only intervenes when the balance of power breaks down. We are the last great power to enter World War I and World War II. We let others do most of the fighting, very ruthless of us. And we, of course, are in the best position then to win the peace. The United States couldn't pass the buck during the Cold War, so we had to take on the main burden of containing the Soviet Union, but I would argue containment was still consistent with offshore balancing. We just had to do most of the heavy lifting ourselves. We had to be onshore. And then finally, in the Gulf, we stayed offshore in the Persian Gulf. We were worried or concerned about energy resources in the Gulf from World War II onward, but we first relied on Great Britain to handle things there, then on the Shah of Iran, and on, to some degree, Saudi Arabia. When the Shah falls, we create the rapid deployment force. Now we think we have to take care of this ourselves, but we don't park it in the Persian Gulf. We leave it offshore over the horizon. We only use it for the first time in 1991 by bringing it in. And it's only after the first Gulf War, when the Clinton administration adopts dual containment, that we leave this strategy and start leaving substantial military forces in the Gulf region. By the way, one of the consequences of that is the 9/11 attacks. So that worked out well for us. In short, I would argue for nearly a century, offshore balancing prevented the emergence of dangerous regional hegemons that enhanced American security. And in the places where you can see the United States sort of losing sight of those principles or abandoning them, Vietnam War, inconsistent with offshore balancing, and our most recent attempt to remake the Middle East, the result was, of course, a costly failure. Now, I'm going to try to anticipate some possible counterarguments, so let me walk through what I think are the main counterarguments to this, and then say a little bit how this would work, and then I'll wrap up. So there are a number of sort of obvious counterarguments that defenders of liberal hegemony make. One argument is that this strategy would undermine American global leadership and place our position of primacy at risk. First point I'd make is that global leadership is not an end in itself. It's a means to an end. You have to explain how somehow global leadership, whatever that is, translates into greater security or greater prosperity for the United States. I would argue that by focusing on vital interests and avoiding costly quagmires, offshore balancing would allow us actually to prolong our current favorable position. We could invest more in the long-term foundations of power, like education and infrastructure and research and development. Just again, a footnote there, you should remember the United States got to be a great power in part by expanding across North America, but also by staying out of big, costly, expensive wars and building a world-class economy here in North America. In other words, we did exactly what China is trying to do today, stay out of trouble overseas and concentrate on domestic development. So a strategy that allows us to do a lot less abroad would actually prolong our position of primacy. The second counterargument is that, well, American leadership is necessary because local actors in key areas might not react fast enough to stop an emerging threat. Again, I think offshore balancing recognizes that problem. There's a possibility that balances won't form, and if that happens, the United States does, in fact, have to step in. So I don't think that objection works. Some people argue that Hillary Clinton has said things like this in the past. American leadership is needed to deal with various transnational problems like terrorism, crime, climate change, refugees, and things like that. And that may be true, but there's nothing in offshore balancing that's inconsistent with trying to address some of those issues as well. And if we weren't running around trying to remake the world as much as we have been, some of those problems would not be as substantial. The refugee problem Europe is dealing with, of course, is a direct consequence of the Iraq war and subsequent things we have done there. Finally, another argument is that, well, we have to stay in Europe and Asia and lots of other places to keep the peace, right? That's what we're doing. We're garrisoning the world to keep other states from fighting each other. If we stop doing this, we're going to gradually see the reemergence of great power rivalry in various places, and we're eventually going to be back in the 1930s, and we'll have another, you know, run-up to World War II. And World War II was pretty expensive, so it's better for us to keep being global policemen rather than rerun history there. I think the problem here is it assumes that American engagement in different corners of the world always ensures peace, and of course that's not true. First of all, there's plenty of wars that have been fought in various places where the United States stayed out. We didn't prevent them, we didn't try to stop them, and we didn't get dragged into them. So the idea that we have to sort of ensure peace so we don't get dragged into another World War II, I think it doesn't follow. But secondly, we've been causing a bunch of wars in recent years. We're not universally a source for peace and stability in various parts of the world. But to put it in slightly different terms, if liberal hegemony as a strategy were supposed to keep the peace around the world, it's doing a very poor job, particularly if you look at all the places we're now fighting. So I think we don't, in fact, have to play global policemen there. And then last but not least, there is, I think, the argument that if the United States were not performing this expansive security role, some states that are accustomed to American protection would be tempted and maybe decide to acquire nuclear weapons. So we have to stay out there fully engaged and committed in order to prevent proliferation. And I think there is something to this case. Now, to be fair, no grand strategy is, I think, going to be 100% successful at stopping proliferation. But it's worth noting that liberal hegemony did not stop North Korea, India, or Pakistan from either crossing the nuclear threshold or expanding their nuclear arsenals. It didn't prevent Iran from becoming a late nuclear power, despite the recent agreement. Second, states normally are interested in a nuclear deterrent because they fear being attacked. By staying out of the regime change business, offshore balancing would reduce some states' incentives to cross the nuclear threshold. Now, again, I think a few states might ultimately decide they had to get their own deterrent, and then we could get into the argument of just how serious those consequences might be. You know, as a student of Ken Walt's, I am not as alarmist as some on that point. I just remind everybody that 10 states have obtained nuclear weapons since 1945. The world did not turn upside down every time a new state joined the nuclear club. So again, proliferation is a concern. This might have some negative consequences, but on balance, I actually think offshore balancing would make this problem less severe rather than more severe. One final thing. There are those who would say this is a bad strategy because the United States has, in fact, a moral obligation to promote democracy, defend human rights, and moreover, because democracies don't fight each other, spreading democracy is a good idea. It's a good strategy. It is, in fact, the road to permanent peace in the world. So we have to keep pushing this. Now, first of all, we don't know if an all-democratic world would, in fact, be peaceful. We do know that new democracies, states that have recently made the transition to democracy, are actually more prone to conflict than other types of government. So in, at least in the short to medium term, this is not going to enhance global stability. But more importantly, I think the last 25 years have suggested pretty strongly that spreading democracy or toppling dictators at the point of a gun doesn't work very well and instead leads to these endless wars. Now, you sometimes hear people saying, okay, you're right, the last 25 years hasn't gone that well, we've made a lot of mistakes, but we can learn, we can do better, we can fine-tune this strategy. You know, if you allow us to keep practicing, we're going to get good at this regime change business. I think this is a delusion. By definition, regime change involves social engineering. It involves a bunch of people coming from the United States and trying to organize institutions and societies where we barely understand what's going on. We have enough trouble governing our own country now. We have enough trouble making politics work properly, say, in the state of Illinois. Just to pick one example, I don't want to say anything about Rhode Island, but I could. And for us to believe that we know how to reorganize politics in Afghanistan or Iraq or any of the other places that have been the beneficiaries of American attention, or that we're going to get much better at this if we keep practicing, I think is illusory. In fact, I would argue if we want to spread democracy and human rights and all those other good things, and I think we should, the best thing we could do is set a good example to the world. If others saw the United States as a just, fair, tolerant, prosperous society where political institutions worked reasonably well, they would be more likely to want something similar for themselves, probably adapted to their own local circumstances. So building a democracy that actually worked here at home might be the best way to encourage it abroad, as opposed to how we've been trying to do it. So let me just say how this would work in practice, and then I'll stop. The good news is it's hard to foresee a significant rival to the United States emerging in the Western Hemisphere anytime soon. And for now, there's no potential hegemon in Europe or the Persian Gulf. The bad news from this perspective is if China keeps developing and keeps enhancing its capabilities, it's likely to seek a dominant position in Asia. I don't mean it's going to try and expand and conquer the whole place, just as we didn't try to expand and conquer all the Western Hemisphere. But I think it will want a dominant position, not dissimilar to the one we have here. We would like to rely on local powers to balance China, but that may not work. They may not be up to the task. And China is likely to be a lot stronger than its neighbors. Those states are distant from one another, have trouble coordinating action. So you could argue that this is the one place where American power may, in fact, be indispensable, where the United States is going to have to balance China for sort of offshore balancing reasons. By contrast, there are no potential hegemons in Europe. Russia and Germany both have declining populations. No one else is in a position to dominate the continent. I'm not even sure either of them are. So the United States could actually remove its military forces and turn European security gradually back over to the Europeans. Here it's worth noting, by the way, that Europe has more than 500 million people. right, the EU population. Its combined economy is, I think, 17 trillion. Mark will correct me.
Same as the US,
basically. Right, but basically, Russia has less than 140 million people. Its GDP is less than 2 trillion. NATO's European members, just the European members of NATO alone, not us, not Canada, included, spend four times more each year on defense than Russia does. So if Europe can't defend itself against the mighty Russian Republic, you know, what's going wrong here? What are they doing terribly, terribly wrong? Why exactly does the United States need to be the first line of defense against the potential threat from Russia? As for the Gulf, I think the United States should basically go back to the offshore balancing strategy that we used in the past. We should let local powers deal with threats like ISIS. If Russia wants to take the lead in Syria, fine by me. Assyria stabilized under Assad or divided into quarreling mini-states does not threaten vital American interests. The only long-term solution to the many disturbing problems there are the creation of more effective local governing institutions, and that's not something we can do. Not something we know how to do, and it's certainly not something we can do with ground troops or drones or air power or things like that. For now, the United States should be pursuing a better relationship with Iran. We don't want Tehran to abandon the nuclear agreement when it expires, and it's more likely to do that, of course, if it thinks the United States is still thinking about maybe trying to overthrow it at some point. You could also make the argument that over time, China is going to want more influence in the Middle East for various reasons of its own, and Iran was likely to be near the top of the list of potential partners for China. We, I think, have no strategic interest in closer ties between Iran and China, but that means we should be reaching out to Iran as well. There's a caveat there. You know, Iran does have substantially greater power potential than any of the other countries in that area. It may one day be in a position to really dominate the Gulf region. This is what the Shah wanted, and it's possible that even the Islamic Republic would want to do that. If it did move in that direction, which won't happen anytime soon, then I think the United States would want to preserve a balance of power there, which means we would tilt towards the various Gulf Arabs. And we calibrate the level of effort to the how serious we thought the problem really was. Now, a footnote to that is if the importance of Middle East oil declines, and one could make the argument that it will and it should, in part for environmental reasons, then our concerns about who controls the oil in the Middle East go down, and the need to prevent someone from dominating that region goes down too. Okay, so what does this all mean? Well, this means if you followed this blueprint, the United States could reduce its defense spending to roughly the level of GDP that the other major powers do, say, you know, 2-2.5% as opposed to 3-4%. We would still have substantial naval and air assets. We'd have modest but capable ground forces. We would be ready to expand those forces if we had to. But for the foreseeable future, we'd spend a lot less money on that. We'd either devoted to other national needs, or we'd leave it in taxpayers' pockets. There'd be a nice political fight here at home over which of those outcomes you'd get. The point is, this is a grand strategy that begins with sort of a certain degree of confidence in our geopolitical position, in our core traditions, that recognizes we actually have enormous advantages. It exploits the country's fortunate geographic position. It takes advantage of the fact that other states also have incentives not to be dominated by others, and therefore will do more in their own interest. It very much respects the power of nationalism around the world. It doesn't try to impose American values on foreign societies, and especially not with military force. And it focuses rather on setting an example that others may want to emulate in their own fashion. In other words, this is a strategy that I think hews closest to our interests, but also, goes back to where I started, is actually much closer to what most Americans actually want. Not people who work inside the Beltway, necessarily, but most Americans. It's the grand strategy that we want, and I would argue that the American people deserve. And the only interesting question is how long will it be until somebody actually tries to give them this strategy? That I don't know the answer to. but I hope it's sooner than I sometimes expect. So let me stop here. Thanks for listening, and I'll look forward to questions, comments, violent disagreements, or anything else you want to say. Thanks. I've driven Steve Kinzer from the room.
He agrees with everything you said.
I've thought this before.
We have plenty of time for Q&A since you were very efficient in your presentation. So I'm sure we have many comments and questions. So you stole my pen, which you can keep because you need to take notes, but I will challenge myself to remember up here who's on the list. Jeff.
Steve, thank you so much. A very good talk, and really enjoyed it, and share many of the group. We'll leave both the realist versus liberal stuff to dinner time. I want to ask you two questions.
Sure.
One is the point that you started with, which I really agree with, which is the issue of the Washington foreign policy establishment. For those of you who don't know, Steve wrote an article in mid-August this year, that was just before your summer break in foreign policy, where you really let loose in some of the rage that that's built up and the sort of lack of accountability of the foreign policy elites that are in Washington, and those that were advocating for the 2003 invasion of Iraq that are still there, that still have jobs advising policy, and that nothing's changed, right? That there's no accountability whatsoever. And I think that point is exactly right. And so my question for you is how to address that. And the concern I have about it is that we don't seem to be able to rely on the ballot box to provide that accountability. If you look at the present election, you're exactly right that if this is your issue, then Trump is the guy that you vote for. And there's no way I'm voting for Trump. And so that's not me neither. That's not a viable alternative. And so maybe you make the claim, well, we need some other form of populism to hold elites, foreign policy elites in particular, accountable to that, but I just don't see that as viable. So what processes, what institutions, how do we do this rather than, how do we improve the marketplace for ideas rather than just be frustrated about it? That's a long question. My next one will be very, very short, so I know it's long, but I want to push you a little bit on the offshore balancing approach. Do you really mean that on September 12, 2001, the U.S. should say to Afghanistan, we know you're harboring Osama bin Laden, and you should really stop doing that, and if you don't, we're going to say stop again. We're not going to do any sort of military invasion. So the concern here is that if we allow, if the U.S. allows failed states to do what they do, which is to fail, to provide terrorist havens, to provide refugee crises, to provide pirates, etc., is that an adequate strategy for the United States?
Okay. Let me do that in reverse order. I thought going after Osama bin Laden and al-Qaeda in Afghanistan was exactly the right thing to do. If somebody attacks you and kills 3,000 people and flies planes into the Pentagon, you don't sort of give them a pass and say, please don't do that again. Now, so going after al-Qaeda didn't bother me at all. I thought, in fact, we should have focused very much on that. And by the way, we should have caught it, right? Instead, well, of course, we screwed up the invasion. We toppled the Taliban, but we lost sight of bin Laden at two battles, Battle of Tora Bora and Operation Anaconda. And the commander of the operation, by the way, General Tommy Franks, does his career suffer as a result of these battlefield failures? No, he's chosen to command the invasion of Iraq in 2003. He's actually an example of non-accountability, right? A general should have been fired for failing to do the mission, which was to catch bin Laden. And just sort of imagine how much better off we would have been if we caught bin Laden way back then and just brought him out, brought him home, whatever, and then not stayed around to try and create a Western-style democracy in Afghanistan, which is what we chose to do, along with our various NATO partners and others, which was a crazy idea. And by the way, it was a crazy idea that I thought was a good idea at the time. And I could point you to an article I wrote back then. Now, that effort might have worked if we had then not done Iraq. It's possible if we'd really just focused on the Afghan problem completely, the Taliban might never have come back. I'm somewhat skeptical of that, but I'm open to that possibility. But the point is that I don't think offshore balancing means you never use military force, or you don't even use it in some places. You don't try, I think, to do a lot of nation building, because we're not very good at that. And we inevitably end up having to fight these various wars of occupation in one form or another, for a variety of different reasons, tend to make these problems worse. How to fix this? Peter and I were talking about this earlier. You said at the end, you know, how do you improve the marketplace of ideas here? I mean, I've thought a lot about this problem, and I don't have a brilliant answer. But I think the only way this changes is essentially through political action, more or less at the grassroots, or at least there has to be a genuine political movement that emerges to sort of push these sets of ideas. So this is all part of a book that I'm desperately trying to finish now. But one of the arguments in the book is if you look at the sort of foreign policy establishment broadly defined in the United States, it is heavily biased in favor of sort of liberal hegemony and global activism. There's tactical disagreements between different folks at, you know, Carnegie Endowment or Brookings or AEI or Heritage or any of the other think tanks, or I hasten to add at most schools of public policy, the Kennedy School, the Wilson School, SICE, etc. But almost all of those people are really comfortable with the idea of the United States trying to run the world. Because among other things, it's a full employment policy for them, right? And I think also many of them genuinely believe it. They think they're out there doing good, right, et cetera. Nobody goes off to Washington to do less, right? By contrast, there's hardly anybody arguing on the other side, arguing the sort of more restrained offshore balancing position. The Cato Institute, right, is probably the only sort of major think tank, libertarian think tank in Washington. And there's some sort of left-wing groups of various kinds. If you just add up the resources involved here, the number of people, et cetera, it's overwhelmingly swayed to one side. And then finally, let's consider like the three most important newspapers in America, right? Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, and New York Times. Who's the sort of realist, restrained, offshore balancing columnist who writes regularly for one of those papers? He or she does not exist, right? They are all liberal hegemonists of one kind or another. So one indicator, now, the other thing is that publishers are sensitive to this thing. So if there were a substantial fraction of the American body politic that was actually sort of organized and visible and had some momentum, some publishers would eventually start saying, you know, we ought to put at least one person. We ought to get Steve Kinzer and rescue him from the Boston Globe.
And the Washington Institute.
Right. And we ought to give him a bi-weekly column in the Wall Street Journal. Not because we necessarily agree with him, but because that view ought to be represented. It's a legitimate perspective in the foreign policy world. Right now, right, you don't see that view except in, you know, the American conservative and international security, which occasionally. And, you know, once every now and then, Foreign Affairs will publish somebody like me. So to get a better marketplace of ideas, I think you have to start by basically creating a sort of a movement. And that requires resources and funding and organization and things like that. And if you don't get that movement beginning to emerge and trying to compete for bandwidth in the policy debate, then we're going to keep doing the same things we've been doing, because the dirty little secret here is the United States can afford to. It's an all-volunteer force. We're a very wealthy country. The consequences generally are not visited back upon us in any clear and discernible way. And so, you know, we leave a lot of damage in other places, but people here don't connect what we're doing there to what's going on back home.
Liz?
Thanks so much, Steve. A really fascinating talk. And I mostly agree with you, but I want to ask about one aspect that's subnational, which has to do with the refugee crisis, right? So, I mean, it's all well and good, and I actually don't disagree with you about leaving the Middle East to the Middle East, especially because, you know, I do think oil is increasingly less important. But then you have 2 million, you know, refugees in Europe. And I'm particularly concerned about that population for two reasons. It's really young, and it's really male. And both those things are really bad when you think about violence, right? And so when you think about destabilizing these institutions we care about, and not just about domestic terrorism at home, although I think that's the way it gets framed in the domestic debate, but just really destabilizing these institutions that we care about in Europe, but then what's the solution, right? Like, we don't want to go into ground troops in Syria, but we also don't want these refugees. And so I'm just curious how you, you know, as a realist, see this as a problem, you know, that's both local but becomes global.
So I think that most of what I was talking about was at the sort of level of sort of grand strategy and very militant. Where are you committing American power? Where are you saying you're willing to send American men and women to fight and die? For what purpose? Right? So I wouldn't be doing that in the Middle East. That doesn't mean you couldn't be sending, you know, lots more money to aid refugees. That doesn't mean you couldn't be trying to bolster local governments that are having to deal with these consequences.
And where would you do that? Would you do that in Europe, or would you do that in the Middle East?
We're already doing some of it. I would have been doing it earlier and more. More for Jordan, more for Turkey. The refugee problem hitting Europe is, unfortunately, Europe's problem. I mean, there is not an American solution to that. We can't patrol the Aegean, right? We don't want to take that. And Europe is not, again, I don't want to say that Europe's a wealthy continent itself. It has capability. It has all sorts of political dysfunctions that are a big problem. But we're not going to solve the refugee problem. The other thing to remember is that the reason we have a refugee problem there is partly because we started unraveling the entire Middle East. But the other point to remember is when, and I fault Obama for this, when the Syrian uprising began, we thought we were looking at Egypt again, and we immediately said Assad must go without ever asking the question, do we have the capability to make him go? We didn't. At least not without a big, ugly, nasty fight, which unfortunately we've been seeing. And second, if he goes, are we going to like that any better? And again, I say that as someone who thinks, you know, he's a war criminal. But we played a role, and it was not a constructive one, in producing that particular carnage, because we're very quick to see this as another possible win for, you know, the democratic transformation of the Middle East. I wish that had been true, but there were good reasons to be skeptical from the very beginning.
So this lack of an anti-liberal hegemony, this culture of foreign policy, I completely agree. I come up against it in DC all the time as well. And the one that I butt my head up against all the time and get told off for all the time is the way that Europe has been writing checks it can't cash through NATO expansion, which is just absolutely ridiculous. And we've gone to the point where Clinton has proposed tentatively a no-fly arrangement over Syria, which is tantamount to saying we're going to shoot Russian planes down. So we're giving them F-15s to piss them off on the Baltic borders. We're putting radars up against them to guarantee against non-existent missiles from the Middle East that might occasionally come over in someone's fantasy. We're definitely encroaching in terms of this wonderful project of bringing democracy, human rights, and cheap labor all the way right to the Urals. And we wonder why the Russians are pissed. So my question on this one is, don't they see it? I mean, do the people inside the Beltway, don't they understand that they're that close to actually being in a shooting war with people who have capacity to hurt you? And they're the Russians. They will hurt you.
I think there are some people who are mindful of this. I mean, I do think, you know, even Obama himself has sort of understood. I mean, his great aversion to getting deeply involved militarily in Syria, I think, is in part cognizance of that. I think that there has been, I share your, you know, occasional sort of lack of, like, I don't get that they don't get it, the incomprehensibility of it all. Just a couple of things. I think this goes back, actually, to the early 90s. You know, we win the Cold War, we're having the usual post-victory euphoria, right? That we're magical, the first Gulf War goes really well, our military is really great, our economy's doing pretty well by the mid-90s. And there is this optimism that, as you put it very well, we can extend a lot of checks that will never get cashed. The belief in the 90s was if you just keep spreading these institutions, they're like a calming oil in the waters, And we just spread peace the more we extend these guarantees. Back in the old days, you formed an alliance when you wanted to pool your capabilities with somebody, because they could do something for you and you could do something for them. Right? What happened from 1993 onward was it became unilateral security guarantees. We just began saying, here are more and more places that we're going to protect, whether they have any real capabilities and whether or not they're actually really very vulnerable. This was not very smart, but the assumption was it wouldn't matter because they're never going to be threatened.
So then the key thing is, how can they? I totally buy that.
And one final thing, the same thing was true with Ukraine. I believe one of the great mysteries is why no one in the US government ever asked the question, gee, if the EU accession agreement goes through and you know, it's got, by the way, a little bunch of stuff on security cooperation, and the third part of it was all about, you know, is there anything the Russians might do about this? Might this upset them? We should at least game this out and think about what their responses might be. And as near as I can tell, nobody even saw it as a possibility, despite the fact that when we proposed Georgia and Ukraine for NATO membership back in 2008, the rest of the Europeans didn't buy it, but we had pushed it. The Russians made it crystal clear, in part by fighting a little war with Georgia, right, that they would do whatever they could to prevent this from happening. Now, you don't have to like that. You don't have to approve of it. You may think it was completely illegal, despicable, not good for Ukraine, etc., and maybe a long-term disaster for Russia. But boy, not to have anticipated that this was a possibility, it suggests that whoever was running this had flunked like geopolitics 101. And I don't fully understand why that still persists. I think it is sort of this very deep Wilsonianism that's still embedded in large chunks of the American sort of foreign policy.
Micro question. Yeah. In terms of probabilities over the next 24 months, how likely do you think it is that we will get involved in a shooting match with Russia?
I think it's actually pretty low.
Pretty low?
Yeah, I think it's pretty low. But not zero. I could say more, but we should get more questions. I'm sure I'll get the opportunity to say something about Hillary.
So you noted that the U.S. had an offshore balancing strategy once, right, before World War II. I'm wondering if that strategy is actually desirable or even feasible in a nuclear world. So you made the point, you conceded that proliferation might be more likely if the U.S. adopts this strategy. I think that's true, definitely amongst U.S. allies like Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, also the Middle East, countries like Turkey or Saudi Arabia. It strikes me that there's probably less margin for error in these sort of multipolar nuclear environments. If the U.S. were to pull out and kind of wait for a war to start and then come back in, if you have four countries armed with nuclear weapons, you might not want to run that experiment. So I'm wondering what you think about whether nuclear weapons make this strategy less reasonable on like a systemic level.
I guess I don't, not obviously, right? I mean, first of all, if you take the nuclear revolution seriously at all, one can make a pretty powerful argument that I'm actually being more interventionist than is called for. But the United States is a $17 trillion economy, geographically isolated, lots of nuclear weapons. I mean, who's really going to mess with the United States in a way that really matters? And one could make an argument. I occasionally get this from a couple of isolationist friends of mine. It says, you know, so what if China dominates East Asia? Who cares, right? It doesn't matter. That might matter if you're Korea, it might matter if you're Japan, it might matter if you're the Philippines, it doesn't matter to us, right? Especially in the nuclear age, because ultimately our security is safeguarded by that. And if Korea decides to maintain its independence, it needs to have a nuclear deterrent, fine, then the last thing we want to do is be yoked. You know, if Korea wants to defend itself with a nuclear deterrent, that's fine, Korea's on its own. Do I sound like Trump at this point? Well, not, as I said, not
everything.
So I think the question is, you know, how much effort are you willing to go to? How much risk are you willing to run? How much cost are you willing to run to prevent the possibility that some of these states might decide that they're like the United States of America, and in order to be secure, they would like to have a second strike capability? I mean, there is also this amazing double standard that has always run through, you know, strategic thinking in the United States, that somehow we're the only country that's really responsible enough to have these things, maybe the British. right? And others aren't allowed to, and we'll go to enormous lengths, both reassurance, but also in some cases coercion, and in other cases preventive war, to prevent anyone else from defending themselves the way we have decided. We, the mighty United States, with all these conventional capabilities and geographic isolation, you know, is it sort of all that surprising that a few other countries might decide to go down the same road? Last point, this is more your area than mine, but you know, I'm always struck by how few states have gotten nuclear weapons. We actually have not had proliferation in the sense of rapid, you know, lots and lots of countries getting it. I think if we adopted this strategy in a sort of measured way, you might get one or two more countries going. I don't think the Asian countries would, because I'd keep us in Asia, right, for now, because there's a real threat there. Is anybody in Europe going to go nuclear? I'm not sure. Germany? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe the Middle East, but you know, I'd be out of the Middle East anyway, and it might be a problem, but I don't think it's a huge problem for us.
Anyone want to jump the queue because on this issue?
It's not an issue.
Okay, all right. Right.
Well, since you said you'll be out of the Middle East, I'm a Middle Easterner, so I don't think it's likely that the Middle East will be out of here. Because what happens is, you have a geography that's shaped in large part by colonial legacies. Peter Galbraith said that Iraq should be partitioned. No one could dare to do it, because you're opening a huge can of maggots, not only in Iraq, but also in Syria, in Turkey. It's referring to Kemen, it creates a certain domino effect, where it comes back to bite you. So is it really possible to argue for offshore balancing without some sort of reckoning with the existing borders we have and being comfortable with the idea of there will be more interstate war to the point that maybe it will get systemic and the US will have to intervene in a more systemic, potentially closer to home fashion?
How does it bite us?
Well, imagine, very simply is it. I mean, if Syria is divided into three, Iraq is divided into three, some of them are going to be Sunni enclaves and Shiite enclaves, Turkey is going to be a place where the Kurdish enclave is going to be a major problem. Turkey is a NATO ally.
Major problem for who?
For Turkey, and therefore for NATO. Turkey is a NATO ally. They're still a member of the last session.
Okay, so?
Well, you have to, I mean,
but do I have to go fight?
I mean, very simply, you have the Russian case. You have the Georgian war in 2008. You had Ukraine, Crimea's annexation in 2014. You have Russia in Syria. These things spread, and when they spread, they eventually take a systemic nature where you have to intervene at some point. Maybe you're kicking the can down the road.
You have to make a case to me about how, first of all, you've strung together a whole series of events that might or might not happen, right? Right? They might, but they might not. Right, and you could even argue that the probability you get to the end of that chain is, you know, 0.05 or something like that. But even so, you've got to make a case that why is it vital to American security or prosperity to intervene in Turkey because there's a war going on between ISIS and the Kurds and the Turkish government?
No, you practically answered my question with this comment. You said that if Turkey gets partitioned into three, you will not have a problem with that. That's entirely possible. So more interstate war is not necessarily something you're comfortable with.
We're obviously not understanding each other. My point was that you talked about various things happening in the Middle East, and I'm saying it's not clear to me that any of those affect American security very much. I mean, the United States has not cared for the last 50 years that Syria was governed by a thuggish regime. We were largely indifferent to who governed Syria or what was going on. We didn't like it very much, but we didn't care very much about it. We care to some degree on humanitarian grounds now, but it's hard to see what the strategic interest in the United States is as to who's running Syria. And Syria's not a very powerful, not a very important country. Another little number. So the number of people killed, according to the West Point Counterterrorism Center, the number of people killed since 2012 by violent Islamic extremists outside of the war zones, so not Iraq, not Syria, not Libya. Any guess? 279 people. And over half of those were the Paris attacks. Now that's not a good thing, but 279 people over 4 years is not an existential threat, right? There's far more people were murdered in Chicago this year so far than violent Islamic extremists have killed worldwide, again, outside of these active war zones. Right, so you're having, I'm not persuaded that the United States should be committing to defend, protect, intervene in these places in order to make itself secure. Right, it's just, it's, I don't see the connection there. It's not necessarily good for those parts of the world, but it's not a vital security interest for the United States.
In the back.
Just coming back to the domestic politics question, we actually do have, of course, a candidate this year who's running on, it's, depending on what day of the week, a more restrained sort of foreign policy. But what's been interesting with both Trump and kind of on Bernie Sanders on the left is the pairing of suggesting a more restrained policy, but also more economic nationalism, pulling out of trade deals. In Trump's case, immigration restrictions, kind of antipathy towards all kinds of international cooperation. To the extent that, you know, the offshore balancing restraint coalition in academia or Cato, sort of the interesting combination usually of security restraint, but economic, cultural openness, you know, willing to do something about global warming. It seems like politically, to the extent that you might be able to build a coalition, it's, you know, look in some of the European right-wing movements too, it tends to be this populist pairing of let's do less internationally on security, but let's also put up walls on trade, let's say no to immigration, let's say no to particular ethnic or religious groups in particular, let's not cooperate on global warming. Do you see any ways to move past that? Or I guess, especially if you were faced with the, you know, the regrettable options of liberal hegemony or offshore balancing combined with protectionism and immigration restrictionism as a political choice, what do you go for?
Oh, geez.
Are you full Trump or half Trump?
I would have to think about that one. I mean, my
putting aside the Trump agency.
Yeah. Well, let me say a couple of things. So on Trump, right? He said actually three things in this election that were perfectly sensible about foreign policy. Right? They're all debatable, but they're not beyond the pale, not crazy. He said that, you know, foreign policy should be about what's good for the country. Right? That's not exactly a problematic idea. Second, that we shouldn't be doing all these nation-building, you know, dumb wars kind of thing. Who's going to argue that we should be fighting dumb wars? And then that American allies are free-riding on us, right? And that's not good. We're getting taken to the cleaners by our allies. And again, Democrats and Republicans, going back to Dwight D. Eisenhower, have been complaining about that. Robert Gates, you know, gave this famous speech at NATO a few years ago where he, you know, complained about the Europeans. If Trump had just stuck with that, had just said, I want to know my foreign policy, it's these three things, right? If he just stopped there, I believe he'd have been in better shape, right? He'd been in trouble for other reasons. But, you know, as a foreign policy platform, I think that would resonate with lots of people. Unfortunately, there's a bunch of other stuff that I think suggests he doesn't understand how the international economy works. I don't think he's ever sort of grasped the principle of comparative advantage, et cetera. And he's got these other warts as well. So, you know, I'd have to think my way through if you gave me a magic wand and says, look, I can get you your grand strategy on security stuff, but it's going to come with a whole lot of protectionism. Working out the net of that would take me a while. Right? A couple of other things. It is interesting, and I admit a little worrisome, or at least a moment that gives me a mild amount of pause, that there are several people who have said similar things in the past. I think you're referring to them. I mean, Pat Buchanan had some of this in his views, very much in the economic nationalist. And you could put, you know, Ron Paul and Rand Paul in there. And one other problem with almost all of them, I'm not so sure about Rand, is they come with a lot of other baggage. There's a lot of white nationalist baggage, a lot of racist stuff. You know, there's a dark side to there as well. But they've always gotten a little bit of resonance in the American body politics. So the interesting question is, what happens if someone who's a completely normal American politician in every other way, right? Sensible about government regulation, education, whatever, tolerant, likes the melting pot, etc., but has this sort of general foreign policy. And in a funny way, you could argue that we actually have seen such a person. And his name is Barack Obama. And that's, I think, where his, if you read the Atlantic article, right, if you go back and look at what he was saying back in 2008, right, and then what happens to Obama is he gets elected and he's got to run a foreign policy and he's got to run it with the Democratic foreign policy establishment. He's got to go to all those old Clintonites who liked NATO expansion and who liked nation building. And he's got Samantha Power whispering in his ear, telling him that he's got to go save lives. But he's got nobody else to work with. He's got no other allies in Washington. And I think he either gets forced by political expediency, right, or by some bad advice to do certain things that he didn't want to do or now regrets having done. But he's been much more restrained than I think certainly Bush or Clinton would have been. One other point is, in a funny way, Bill Clinton and Barack Obama weren't all that different. Clinton did a bunch of things, but he did them all on the cheap. I mean, NATO expansion, as Mark says, was not supposed to cost us anything. We'd make some money selling weapons to the Poles, and it wouldn't ever get us into any trouble. Dual containment would, you know, facilitate Israeli-Palestinian peace and stabilize the Gulf, and that wouldn't cause any problems as well. And all those chickens came home to roost later. Clinton got lucky. But Clinton, remember, was very careful about using military force. Didn't do Rwanda, got out of Somalia, used cruise missiles, not ground troops, used air power in Kosovo, would not use ground troops when the military wanted him to. Right. Bill Clinton once told George Stephanopoulos, when Stephanopoulos was White House press secretary, remember, Americans are basically isolationists. And Clinton, who I think was pretty smart about American politics, understood that there was a very limited appetite for costly foreign involvement. And so he didn't want to do anything costly. Ambitious foreign policy. We're going to promote democracy, engage and enlarge the sphere of democratic rule, we're going to do it as cheaply as possible. And in a funny way, Obama has done the same thing. Bush is the exception that he did really try a big roll of the dice with Iraq, because he actually believed that would be cheap, too.
In the back.
Yeah. If you had to pick a country that you think is really just killing the 21st century and doing all the things you think are good ideas, where would you go?
That's a great question. Until a year or two ago, I might have said Germany was doing pretty well, with some difficult circumstances. I'm not entirely sure about that, having read Marx's book. You know, I think if you take a 30, 40 year perspective, until very recently, it's hard not to look at China's record and be pretty impressed. And that's not to say it's perfect by any means. But if you look where Chinese per capita income was 30 years ago and where it is today, if you look at the ability of their political system to continue to make progress in a variety of different areas, if you look, again, until relatively recently at the rather restrained foreign policy they've followed, you know, staying out of trouble, they must look at what we've done over the last 10 or 15 years and saying, my God, that's the best gift we've had in a long time. So I think the Chinese have done reasonably well. There's not a lot of, well, one other thing is so I in a funny way, I think Putin has played a weak hand very well, right? Given that he doesn't have a lot of capabilities, he's kind of got a crumbling economy in terms of defending core Russian national interests and taking a country that actually doesn't have a lot of assets, doesn't have a lot of what Joe and I would call soft power. Hardly had, apart from weaponry, has no products. For weaponry and oil and gas, that's basically the only thing they have. No one's buying the new Russian iPhone. No one is breathlessly waiting for the arrival of the new Russian movie, right? You know, etc. He's done, a fairly skillful job at defending some core interests with not many cards to play. But it's true, there's not a, one of the arguments we make is, you know, American foreign policy is pretty screwed up, but so is everybody else's.
Thank you for your talk. So it seems to me that historically we haven't been very good at offshore balancing. I mean, if you look at World War I and World War II as the best examples, like, yeah, we did it eventually, but it took two world wars and two extraordinary presidents to even get there. So I guess my question is, if we were to draw down forces, do you start running into a risk that you'll have less problems, but they'll be far larger? And so the cost-benefit analysis comes out, actually, in fact, on the side of force as well.
Yeah, some of this, I think you have to enter, you have to acknowledge that as a possibility. And then the question you want to ask is, how likely is that possibility? And are you certain that greater American involvement would have either prevented those earlier conflicts or would prevent conflicts for time immemorial, you know, for the foreseeable future? So, you know, if you go back and look at the European great power system in the run-up to World War I and ask yourself, what exactly could the United States have done in 1907 that would have prevented World War I? I mean, I could probably construct a sort of odd counterfactual, but, you know, you could make the argument that the Germans really thought they had a serious problem with Russia and they had the wherewithal to try a bid for hegemony. And it's kind of sort of almost an alternate universe that you could have imagined, you know, Wilson or Roosevelt or one of those people saying, we're going to create a large army and park it in France to deter Germany from starting World War I. I mean, and even there, it's not clear to me that that would have worked, right? And therefore, we would have been in World War I, and we would have been in it from the very beginning. And as the states that fought World War I discovered, it wasn't a whole lot of fun from 1914 to 1917. It was really pretty awful. So, you know, that counterfactual doesn't necessarily make me think, well, that's what, you know, the offshore balancing is a bad idea. What happened in Europe was terrible, but from an American perspective, to get in when we did was sort of the smart thing to do. And there are circumstances in which we might never have gotten involved if the Europeans had somehow managed to reach an armistice in 1916, so we would have stayed out. And similarly, you know, yes, if the United States had committed itself against Germany in 1934 and sent a stern message to Adolf Hitler that we were going to oppose him if he tried anything, you can tell a story that would have worked and prevented World War II. But do you really think Hitler was that deterrable? I mean, Hitler really is out there in terms of extreme leaders, extreme movements, and I can tell you a counterfactual where, you know, the German military is afraid of America, so they get rid of him in 1936 and we avoid it. But then if you think of sort of Germany there, the Soviet Union industrializing, there's still a lot of potential for trouble in Europe, and are you really convinced the United States would have prevented war in Europe among the European powers forever? So I guess my answer here is yes, there is some possibility that a reduced American role in some parts of the world might eventually open the door to renewed great power competition, which then leads you to the question of, well, how likely do you think that really is in Europe? Right? I will defer to Europeanists, but I don't see great power war in Europe happening. I mean, there's maybe some possibility of a Russia move against the Baltic states, but that's not a great power war. Russia's not going to attack Poland. Russia's not going to attack Germany. And if Russia did, that's the other thing. If Russia did, Russia would have a terrible time taking any of these places. They had enough trouble, actually, with Georgia. They're not a remarkable military power. And if they did manage to conquer these places, they'd have a terrible time running them, right? They would face insurgencies. Nationalism is very powerful. Do you think Lithuanians have forgotten how to kill Russians? They were pretty good at it at various points, and they would learn very quickly again how to do it, which is, of course, why Russia doesn't want to do that. You ever ask yourself why Russia hasn't taken all of Ukraine, if it's this mighty military power and Putin wants to recreate the old Soviet Union? Because actually, Putin is smart enough to realize that he doesn't want to try and run Ukraine, because most Ukrainians do not want to be run by Russia and Moscow. And he would just face another bleeding, running sword there. So in a sense, I don't think there's a big probability of a great power struggle in Europe in my lifetime. And the idea that you have to keep the United States there to prevent that from happening means you really don't believe in democratic peace theory at all. You really don't think the European Union has any consequences whatsoever. And you realize that they're really going to go back to the 1930s as soon as our backs are turned. And I guess I don't believe that.
Going off of that point, but you did talk about how, like, American intervention is required to prevent a hegemon from rising. So wouldn't that mean, for example, in Southeast Asia with China, wouldn't that mean having American troops there?
Yeah.
So what does it mean to intervene and to prevent a hegemon? Because it seems like you'd be opposed to that, but also in favor of that.
So I did say that the one part of the world that I think you can see a potential hegemon that could emerge, might not. I mean, the Chinese economy may turn down. They may have enough problems at home. They have all sorts of things they have to deal with. Some of the countries near China are not exactly pushovers. Japan is still a consequential military power. It's the world's third largest economy, capable in various ways. South Korea is pretty sizable force as well. So it's not a cakewalk for China to dominate Asia. And I don't think China wants to conquer the place or has the capability to do so. But if I were China, I would want a situation where all the countries that surround me or nearby basically are deferential. They don't do certain things. And in particular, I would like a situation where the world's most powerful country did not have strategic alliances and military forces arrayed around my borders, right? If you ever look at a map at the number of foreign powers that are arrayed with military bases near the United States, the answer is sort of exactly none, right? And none of the countries near us have nuclear weapons. If you look at a map of China, right? We've got military bases in South Korea and Japan, Okinawa, and the Philippines. We're flirting now. I should have mentioned Australia. We're flirting now with Vietnam again, right? And there's this long relationship with Taiwan, although we don't have bases there. There are four countries on China's borders that have nuclear weapons: Russia, North Korea, India, Pakistan. China's geopolitical situation is a whole lot worse than ours, but if I were the Chinese, I'd really love to get the Americans out of there. Not necessarily by next Tuesday, but over the next 10 or 20 years. And so what you're seeing happening with China and the Philippines is very interesting, where the Chinese are sort of, why don't you sort of distance yourself from those Americans? They're no good for you. They're just going to get you into trouble. We can do more for you. We can do development assistance. And, you were a colony of theirs. You don't want to be a colony of theirs anymore. And maybe that will work. It appears to be having at least some resonance with the Philippine president. I think we would prefer that not to happen. And for us, the challenge is sort of how much does the United States have to do to try to sort of coordinate activities from other Asian countries so that they all feel like they don't have to be deferential to China? Why does this matter to the United States? And it probably doesn't matter much in my lifetime, but probably will in all of yours. In theory, right, a China that didn't have to worry at all about its neighbors because it had a dominant position would be like us here in the Western Hemisphere. We don't worry about protecting ourselves from Canada. And despite what Trump says, we don't really worry about protecting ourselves from Mexico or anybody else, which, as I said before, is what allows us to wander all over the world. Right? If we had to protect ourselves against a mighty, powerful, great Canada, We focus a lot of attention on our northern border and things like that. We don't. A China that didn't have to worry anymore about Japan or Korea or any of those other countries, if it wished, could focus more power on influencing events in other parts of the world. Say, the Middle East, where it can get a lot of energy resources. Possibly Africa, where it may get other resources as well. Conceivably, even the Western Hemisphere. You know, it's not beyond imagining that 70 years from now, China and Brazil would have a strategic partnership. When we've been allied with Europe and Japan for 40 or 50 years, why couldn't China say, we've got some economic ties, and furthermore, we have some security concerns, and we worry about those Americans, so an alliance with Brazil. And you could imagine the Brazilians saying, yeah, that's not such a terrible idea. Well, if China has to worry mostly about Asia, because there are other states there who are not necessarily deferential to China in any and all circumstances, that's a China that can interfere less in other parts of the world. That's the argument for sort of staying engaged in Asia. But just to wrap that up, that's not going to be easy. It's a very complicated diplomatic problem for the United States. And I hope we are up to it, but I'm not sure that we are.
Nina's been trying to get in here.
Oh.
Mark has a two question.
No, Nina, go ahead.
So I do want to engage in the realism-liberalism debate. And we have quite a number of undergraduates here who are going to be writing papers on realism and liberalism, and we can now get it from a horse's mouth here.
Very simple. Realism, good.
That won't get you an A. Okay.
You have to unpack that a bit.
Okay, so here's the question. I mean, the implication of your presentation today is that realism does not explain much of state behavior, right? You're offering realism as a prescription. But the implication is that you're essentially arguing that the U.S. does not have a realist foreign policy. It's driven by liberal hegemony, what you're calling liberal hegemony, which is, there's a belief system there, right? So this is a very unrealist explanation. And so not only the United States, but your sort of general explanation about critique of state behavior around the world is that it's not realist enough, right? So realism doesn't seem to explain much of state behavior. So what are the limits of realist explanation, you as a realist? What are the limits of realism, and what are the basic explanations for the state behavior that you do see?
Well, I'm not going to concede this ground quite so quickly. realism, I think, in its modern sort of incarnations, whether sort of the Waltzian form or, say, you know, Mearsheimer's offensive realism, realism is a theory about constraints. It's a theory about the pressures that all major powers are under because they live in a world where there are other major powers that they have to worry about, right? And that again, for realists, forces states to do various things they might not want to do, causes unintended consequences, etc. You know, balances of power forming, and you know the basic logic. So I would argue that from 1993 onward, you've had an unusual situation. You want to call it unipolarity, we can talk about that. But where the United States was pretty unconstrained, not completely unconstrained, but the disciplining effects that sort of systemic pressures normally have on countries were relaxed for the United States, and therefore we could do a lot of crazy stuff without a whole lot of consequences. It's not to say that realism is wrong, but realism does not lead you to tight predictions about what the United States is going to do. There's more latitude for domestic politics, for ideology, for other things to play. So I'm not sort of abandoning realism. I'm suggesting that this is a set of circumstances where the realist prescriptions can be evaded. However, what a realist would also say is that even for a very powerful country, if you start ignoring some of the basic lessons or guidance that realism gives, you will pay a price for it. You can go off and do some crazy things, but it'll hurt, and they won't work out very well. Somehow, weak countries like Syria and Iran will find ways to make your life really miserable in Iraq, which they both did in various ways. They'll get together to make it even more miserable, and that's going to cause some trouble for you. It's not that you can, not that they can conquer you. It's not that they can, you know, cause you to go under, but they can make life difficult for you. So I'd argue that I think realism still subsumes this, but it's true. It doesn't give you a precise guidance. We've been in the position where we kind of, we can act in a non-realist fashion and to some degree get away with it. I would also argue that whenever the United States gets in real trouble, which happens occasionally, or thinks it's in real trouble, boy, do we act like realists, right? So, you know, World War II comes along, we suddenly decide we're in a big war. Who can we ally with? How about Joe Stalin? He's a great guy. Or we lose in Vietnam, right? And we think the Soviet Union is getting ahead of us. Who do we go to? We go to China. Mao Zedong, one of the great mass murderers of all time. And suddenly he's our buddy because he's helping us balance a bigger problem as well. And one more kind of realist thing we do, a bunch of crazy guys from Saudi Arabia and elsewhere get lucky and attack us on September 11th. What does the United States do? We declare war on international terrorism everywhere, right? We go into Afghanistan. We eventually go into Iraq. We throw our constitution out the window to some degree, right? We act the way, you know, screw our values. We're going to go, we torture people, right? We do all sorts of really nasty Machiavellian things because we've convinced ourselves that we're facing some really great, great danger out there. So I don't think realism is completely obsolete just yet.
You had a two-finger there?
It's just a legal suggestion for the undergrads in particular and anyone who's interested at feeding off the question that you asked. So imagine the world in which the United States is very powerful and tries to pre-deploy, and that's going to stop the system playing out the way it does. Well, Adam Tooze has a book called The Deluge about the interwar period, and he makes the exact opposite claim, which is it's the fact of American strength coming so late in the war that scares the bejesus out of the traditional elites in Europe, who for the first time are confronted with the reality of American military and financial power. And they realize the world's going to be whatever these guys say, and they're out of business. And that's what sets them on the road to fascism. So it's the very fact that the Americans did intervene that created the conditions.
In during World War I?
Yeah. At the end, intervening in World War I creates the 1920s, because the specter of Americanization is what unites all the fascists. So
oh, that's
really
good.
Great book.
That's really interesting. I haven't read that book.
Yeah, so I started reading it, I was like, okay, this sounds mental, and then 100 pages in, I was like, no, this is actually kind of genius.
But the other little part of this, right, which is always hard for Americans to sort of recognize, because we're the good guys, we only do nice, benevolent things, is just how hard-nosed American statesmen were after World War II as well, right? And the Europeans and the British in particular can tell us a long story about how much fun it was to deal with us over, you know, creating Bretton Woods and all of that and decolonization, whatever. And the Americans were just very, very tough because we had all these high cards. We knew we had all these high cards and we were willing to play them with our allies. These are with our buddies, let alone what we were willing to do with our enemies. I'm not saying this in a bad way. We're a fairly hard-nosed country most of the time.
I'll throw in a final question here. It's very strange to hear realists say we need a political grassroots. That's just weird. But maybe it's also something that makes you a little more user-friendly to non-realists.
I am large. I contain multitudes.
That provoked me thinking, who's your audience for this pitch? Because, you know, you're writing, this is in Foreign Affairs, and then maybe a book, the grassroots movement. It's funny you mentioned Trump many times, libertarians, Buchanan, who also wanted to build a wall, by the way. He originally was the wall builder. The silence is the whole Bernie Sanders phenomena, who would agree with you in the political movement, and it should be outside the beltway, because the people inside the Beltway are committed to doing things the way they've been doing it for a long time. But just, I'm wondering, you know, Bernie Sanders would put a lot of humanitarian wrapping around this, and he spent most of his campaign talking about the financial crisis in Wall Street greed and so on, but on foreign policy stuff, when he was forced to talk about it, which wasn't a stated thing to talk about, I'm just wondering, you know, sounds pretty Bernie Sanders-ish. Is that a fair statement?
I could never quite figure out what Bernie's foreign policy really was. I mean, it sounded okay, but he didn't know very much about foreign policy. That was not what got him into the campaign. That's not what made him attractive. It is true that he was sort of, when he did talk about foreign policy, it was sort of from a good non-interventionist point of view, but you never got him to unpack, you know, what he would actually do with anything. It was not his pitch. And I didn't think he was going anywhere. I turned out to be right there, and I confess I didn't pay an enormous amount of attention to the Sanders campaign, for which I apologize if any of you were big Sanders supporters. My son was. He was like, Bernie was his guy. We did discuss it a bit, but he didn't fully persuade me. Among other things, it always bothered me that Bernie was the second least popular member of the Senate. Right? You all know this, right? That he was like the one of the two. There are two senators who nobody ever has lunch with. Right, and not just because they don't have anything to talk about, it's because nobody likes him. The other one, by the way, was Ted Cruz. Right? Those are two least popular senators, and that I find a little bit troublesome. Well, there's a couple things. One is, sort of gets back to Nina's question. You know, I'm at a public policy school. I have always been interested in trying to use scholarly work to shape events or how people think about things. I don't believe, at least personally, in sort of knowledge for knowledge's sake, that I'm just going to sit up in an ivory tower and write stuff that amuses me and 12 other political scientists. So that I'm kind of drawn to trying to figure out how to solve these things. And having started out, you know, with a view of sort of where how international politics worked, how foreign policy was, what American foreign policy ought to be. I mean, you can go back to the closing chapter of Origins of Alliances, which basically says a lot of the same things. I mean, we're basically in great shape. We've got lots of allies. We're very secure. The main thing we want to do is not screw up too badly. I don't think I've really departed very much from that. But I have been increasingly frustrated by the fact that, you know, why, your point, this is a prescriptive argument, and why isn't the world following my brilliant prescription? And I think there are, you know, that's a puzzle. You know, one possibility is you're just wrong, right? Your prescriptions aren't good prescriptions, and the world is properly rejecting them. And I don't think that's right, but I acknowledge the possibility. Right. Another possibility is that there's a set of domestic political institutions that have a different worldview and some self-interest involved, and that's what explains why we keep doing these things. And, you know, we're able to do that for good structural reasons, for good realist reasons. We're so powerful we can get away with it for a long time. And that's kind of where I've come down to it. It's trying to reconcile my view of how the world works with how the world ought to work and what would be better for the United States, and I believe for many other parts of the world, and the fact that the world hasn't yet conformed to that. But one final thing is I'm not a political activist myself. I don't organize grassroots campaigns. My wife is the politician in the family. So I think my job is to just try and understand these things and write about them. Talks about them. That's my contribution to this. So yes, I'll, you know, your question, who's the audience? The audience is anybody who will read it. And I guess I see my main task here is to try to get people to think about these issues in a different way. Right? And so, you know, the books I write or the foreign policy column is all designed to just, you know, put out what I think is going on and hope that a few people find that it resonates.
We've gone over time. Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you.